All right, part three in my mom's moose room in the middle of the night. We're talking about the evolution of the Krag. So I have a Norwegian Krag, which we'll talk about now. Norwegian Krag, especially mine, my Norwegian Krag was the first Krag I ever bought. It was the first rifle I ever bought, actually. Now, when I was a kid, I had my mom help me get a 22, which is essentially legally mine. I have it listed on my CNR bound book. So, but this is the first rifle I ever bought, which was a Norwegian Krag. This rifle, not just for the fact that it's my first rifle, not for the fact that it's a Krag, but for the fact that this is one of the rarest used service rifles in history, is why it's never going to leave me unless something horrible happens. I'm going to have this rifle for the rest of my life. This, if you know what you're looking at right now, this, not very many people will. Let's get the whole profile. This is a Stomperud Krag. And this isn't one of the Nazi-made Stomperud Krags. No. The Nazis actually made quite a few Krags. I think they made somewhere in the range of 4,000 of their Krags, which have Nazi markings and stuff on them. No. This is a post-war reworking of an older rifle. How do I know? For one, the Nazis had everything proofed with Waffenamts. Waffenamts are military acceptance stamps. And every one of them was stamped with one of those, as well as receiver stampings over the old receivers, over old receiver stampings. They usually had like the year of manufacture and a few other things. But this one is an actual arsenal conversion at Kongsberg Arsenal post-war, because people actually kind of liked the size of the Stomperud Krag. The Stomperud Krag is a shortened version of the M1894 Krag-Jorgensen rifle, the Langkrag. And it was a long-barreled rifle. It, I believe, was like 6 inches longer than my current one. And in the 1940s, the Germans invaded Norway. They took over. It was their country after a certain point. They may as well have been... They were a puppet state. They really were, with Kiesling and everything in control. And so they went to Kongsberg Arsenal and had a bunch of these rifles converted over to a size that was comparable to the K98K Mauser. And so they built a bunch of these. So That goes on for a couple of years, and, you know, I'm pretty dirty today. That stupid starter broke on me. So they do that for a couple of years, and production goes on for a while. People actually, you know, the production wasn't great during that period because the Norwegians weren't really happy with Nazi control. But people like these rifles. They actually really liked these rifles. So post-war, they had a bunch of barreled actions, in Kongsberg Arsenal in Norway. And they had a bunch of stocks that didn't match to things because for various reasons they didn't meet standards. Don't know why. And so a lot of them were produced over into this Stomperud design, which is a short carabiner type length. This is actually still longer than their cavalry length rifle. It still has the original rear sights, which are not modified in any way to match up with the barrel length, so they really are meaningless. And I'll get into another thing where this thing is nearly impossible to zero. And none of the parts really match. Now, in a lot of cases, people would see that as a bad thing, but that's actually a proof of provenance for this rifle. When I initially bought it, I actually had no idea what this rifle was. I just knew I had happened upon a cheap Krag, and cheap Krag is saying a lot. At the time, I bought it for $500 from Cabela's. Well, turns out, probably a week after I bought it, I started looking for pictures of Norwegian Krags, and I was noticing a strange difference between the ones I saw online and mine. And it was this. These steps on the barrel. What the heck was that? So I dug deeper, and I was like, you know, about shortened crags and stuff like that. And I found out the whole story of the Stomperud Krag. Well, Kongsberg Arsenal had all these old barreled actions and stuff. So they took parts, and I'm talking like they took all kinds of just random parts and built rifles out of them. And this is one of them. And they still had, like, this front sight. This is an original front sight. But you'll see a little notch. This is a little holdover from the World War II design. This notch underneath the screw here, which is kind of a weird shape, was so you could put a K98 sight hood on here that wasn't present on any other of the Krags. So that's another little bit of proof. By the way, I thought this thing was bubbed when I first bought it. Bayonet lug. And this is kind of like the nail in the coffin. Show you in a second. Is this. And a lot of people, you know, oh, a little tiny cleaning rod. This thing is dinky. Well, there are two different types of cleaning rods that were this length. There was one for the carbines, but all of the ones for the carbines had knurled tips. The only ones without a knurled tip were the Stomperud Krags. Now, I talk about the rarity. This rifle's one of 1,578 rifles built. This one is unique in various ways. All of the ones released to the civilian market have a special marking. I don't have a photo of it. And you know I don't edit my videos. I just talk. But right next to where you'd have the Norwegian crown would be a little lion holding an axe. And that would be a civilian release marking. This rifle doesn't have that. No civilian release marking. Which means legally this thing couldn't have been sold to civilians. Don't know why. There's also no proof marks, except for the military proof marks. There's no civilian proof marks. So this was never released to the market. Another thing, there's no import marks anywhere. And I'm telling you, I've taken this thing apart and looked for them. There are no import marks anywhere. Not even on the inside of things like the plate here. None. And I, for the life of me, cannot figure out why that is. To have a rifle that was never released to the civilian market, and then it got here, obviously before the 60s, without any kind of import marks, not even country of origin. So, World War II bring back? It's really not likely, but possible. And it's very possible that this was an early Stomperud Krag as well, where the Germans had some of these actions and just never put any of their markings on it. But even then, you would think they would put Waffenamts on there. Not present. It's kind of a mystery rifle. Don't know what's going on with it. That's part of the reason I'm not going to get rid of it. So, let's talk about some of the functions that the Norwegians changed, which wasn't much. Really, what the Norwegians changed from what the Americans had when they adopted this 2 years later after the Americans did, was they did some lightening. So you'll notice on the US Krag, this is way boxier. Literally, it's like a rectangle. This one is cut. It's milled a little bit more, especially here and here. And that's just to lighten the load. Tiny, tiny bits. Another one is right here. That, I assume, is for single-shot loading because it does have a magazine interrupter, which would have been present on the other two rifles. The Danish Krag one is broken, which I'm actually thankful for somebody having broken because it would be in the up position the whole time if I wanted to shoot from the magazine. This one, you can shoot from the magazine with it down. Thank you, Norway. The U.S. Krag, you have to remove it in order to actually run the really fine Redfield sight. I'm serious, that is a fine sight. I love that sight. Otherwise, really, the big difference on the bolt is that this bolt handle, the ball on it, is huge. It really is. Just take a look at that thing. It's massive. I love it. Very tactile. Otherwise, the loading system's the same. Opens out, feeds around. I don't have a round on hand. I do actually have some in my reloading kit, but I don't want to dig them out right now. I'm just way too lazy, and it's 12:30. Another thing, I don't know if they took it from the Americans or they were the ones who thought about it before the Americans adopted the rifle and just added it to what they had or what, but cocking piece is essentially the same. In fact, about a week ago, I went to the shooting range and I mixed up some of the parts between the Norwegian Krag and the U.S. Krag. It turns out the firing pin is interchangeable to the point where they fit into each other, but they won't fire from each other. Real nice. Still kind of a cool learning experience. So, yeah. This, however, the actual striker body is not interchangeable, which would have been kind of cool. I was actually kind of hopeful that everything was going to be interchangeable, and then it'd be like, yeah, I can make a Franken gun, even more so than a Stomperud Krag already is. So you have these lightning cuts. In fact, you have one on this side, too, on the receiver. Here. Another change that isn't really obvious is on this plate, you don't have a screw right here holding it in place. In fact, what holds it in place is this lever. There's a whole rod that kind of goes down this way. And if you turn it and kind of tap on it, it'll pop out. In fact, I just popped it out right there. It's actually really easy to do. I don't do it very often. But, oh, you can see the follower. See that? That's the follower that pushes through. It has serial number ending in 580. This rifle has a serial number on the receiver ending in 319. The bolt has 066. Even the barrel bands are numbered. You got a 190494. So, yeah, Franken gun. In fact, I've actually been able to trace the serial number because for some reason, I don't know why, they put full serial numbers on the stock. The stock is from 1898. So, in some strange way, let me get this. There we go. So, back in place. It's actually really easy to put back in. But the stock is actually older than the rest of the gun. And this barrel band, don't know why. The first or the second barrel band, right here. That one is also full serial numbered. A strange thing. That one's from 1895. So, odd stuff. Also, the... see that? 50144. That's from 1902. Everything else has partial serial numbers. It's the last three numbers on the serial number of the receiver. So I can't really follow them back. Last thing. Really. Oh, this is in 6.5 by 55, which is a lot of people call it Swedish Mauser. It was actually a commission bullet, I guess you can call it. It was agreed upon between the kingdoms of Sweden and Norway while they were unified. And so they basically agreed we'll use the same round for logistics purposes, but we use different firearms. Norway chose this. Sweden, they chose a Mauser design that they kind of worked on themselves with the help of the Mauser company. I mean, I have to admit, the Mauser's superior rifle. Bolt, really, when it comes down to Krags, really, it all is the bolt. It's a beautiful bolt. That's it. The magazine design is so stupid. But I guess it's better than a tube magazine. That's just... Why? Why would you do that to your soldiers? Portugal and France. A 100 years later. So, last thing is that safety I was talking about, this wing safety. Just like the American Krag, I don't know if it was something the Norwegians came up with or the Americans came up with to put it on there. I know it's a copy of what Mauser had on even their earliest rifles. So, there's that. But, like I said, there's no notch on the Norwegian one. Don't know why. No clue. But it's still a good safety. You can tell if you're behind it. As you see in my U.S. Krag one, I couldn't tell just by looking at it from the side because I'm not used to doing it from that angle. But I would have known because there's actually a notch on top of the safety. If you see that notch, you're safe. Or you have it flipped up, you're safe. It's in the way of the sights. But other than that, functionally, it's the same as a U.S. Krag. One thing I can touch on is the rear sight. This is the military sight, of course. The U.S. sights were essentially the same for a while. They did ladder sights as well. This is, you know, typical European-style slider battle sight. Front sight is a blade. Or actually, no, it's a V-notch. You can see that. Yeah, that's an A-blade. And this is a V-notch in the back. Now, about not being able to zero this thing. The big problem is most of the ammunition out there is designed for Swedish Mausers, which a lot of the also hunting rifles out there are 6.5 by 55, and they're based on the Mauser rifling and stuff. So that's one problem. Another problem is whoever owned this rifle left it somewhere and I wouldn't say rusted out the bore because I haven't had any keyholing, but it's pretty heavily pitted. So it's never been able to get much more than a few inches for a group. So really, it's a nice rifle. I love having it. I love having this piece of history that's also still, you know, a big mystery. But you know, it's not going to be a great shooter. I don't think it'll ever be a great shooter. I have changed up, like, I've improved my reloading system. I'm using a digital scale for my powder. Things have improved over time. I haven't shot this in a couple years. So, whenever I give it a try, we'll see how it does. But I'm not holding out hope, really. So, yeah, this has been my nearly 1 hour talk about all three Krags. Part three, this is my favorite Krag, though, you know, my U.S. Krag is the one that's probably the best shooter. But this is the one that makes me the happiest to own. I'm proud of it. And I hope to one day maybe shoot better with it. So thanks for sitting through all this crap with me. I know these have been really long videos, but I love Krags. Krags are my favorite rifles, and eventually I want to make some videos maybe going into more depth and not talking about my personal story about these things, but just talking about the rifles as they are. Have a good night.